Hey guys, my name is Drew-Ashlyn. I'm back with another video. I know I've been gone way too long, but I'm finally here. Can we get a round of applause? So yeah, I've been busy working and it's just been so difficult to get back to this house to actually film for you guys because I've not got my ring light and then I've even not got my stand or anything like that. So I finally got my camera stand, but my ring light is at Gavin's, so I think the dogs are getting fed. So my ring light is at Gavin's, so we're just having to deal with daylight. I'm liking this new setup though, like I'm a bit closer to the camera. This video is basically going to be my 1 year anniversary of my facial surgery. Now, I basically have done videos about my surgery in the past, but I wanted to do a final video to close this chapter of my life, which I think that's reasonable. And I wanted to give you my pros, cons, show you my before and after pictures. So kind of be like quite detailed with it. And then we can move on and then hopefully talk about the next surgery that I have in the future. Let's go! I am now 28. I'm 29 at the end of this year. And I started my transition when I was 18. So it's 10 years that I've been transitioned. And in them 10 years, I've only ever been on hormones. So I was really, you know, looking into facial feminization constantly. I think the first surgery that I used to look up was kind of Adam's apple and breast implants. Then kind of as I got older and I was on hormones a lot more, you know, the whole breast implant idea kind of went out the window and I just wanted to focus on my face because I feel like I've got a reasonable amount that I can work with to create the illusion of having breast implants. So I will do a separate video about that because people to this stage still don't believe that I've had no boob jobs. So yeah, I am very open, I'm very honest, and I wanted to give you my opinion on my surgery. So, I was recommended Dr. Brian Musgrove from my gender clinic when I told them that I was looking into getting my trachea shave, which is the removal of the Adam's apple where they basically shave it down. So, your Adam's apple is built-up cartilage that happens when your voice breaks and it deepens and you start to get more cartilage growing onto your windpipe, I guess. I think that's right. I'm not a medical expert, I'm just using common sense, I guess. So yeah, so I had quite a big Adam's apple, and when you look at my previous videos, you'll be able to see that. So when I went, I finally, you know, had gone online, did loads of research on doctors within the UK. I think because it was my first surgery ever, like I really wanted to stick to that. You know, looking back now, if I'd have known then what I know now, I would have still gone with Dr. Brian Musgrove. But I think for future surgeries, there may be a possibility where I would go abroad. You know, I'm very thorough with my research, very thorough with reviews, the surgeons, the facilities, where everything's placed and stuff like that. So I wouldn't go out my way to go to someone cheaper just in case the results were shit. So yeah, I think that 100% you should always do your research because it's your face at the end of the day, and you know, if it goes wrong, there's nothing we can do. So when I found Dr. Brian Musgrove, I looked at all his work, and a couple of my friends, well, I wouldn't say friends, but a couple of people that I know from YouTube and things like that, they basically had surgery with Dr. Brian Musgrove. So seeing their journeys and seeing what, you know, he achieved with them definitely gave me hope for myself. I always want to look like me, but I wanted to look more of an enhanced feminine version myself, you know, and I've never really kind of been like, oh, maybe I should get this done. I've always been adamant that I was getting my nose done, my jaw, my chin, and my Adam's apple. They were always the surgeries that I wanted from day one. Now, there were other surgeries that I wish I got, like I wish I had my hairline lowered and my brow bone shaved, you know, because I do have quite a big forehead, let's be honest. But, you know, it wasn't something that was really necessary to feminize my face. And looking at my bone structure, when I had my 3D scans, there wasn't much bone here, so it would have been kind of pointless. But I'd still want, you know, a hair transplant to fill this little V that I have here that I cover with makeup. It's not very big, but it's tiny. Anyway, I'm babbling on now. So the surgeries that I had done were my nose, my chin, my jaw, and my Adam's apple. Now, when I went for my consultation, Dr. Brian Musgrove, you know, kind of asked me what I was thinking of having done, and I told him that I definitely wanted my nose done and my Adam's apple. Then I went on and asked him his honest opinion about what else he think I should get. I never told him that I wanted my chin and jaw done because I wanted his honest opinion, and the fact that he actually, you know, said that that would make a big difference definitely was like, yeah, that is what I wanted. wanted. I wanted my jaw and chin reshaved and, you know, made a little bit smaller. The reason why I didn't tell him was because, you know, you can go in somewhere and go into a place and be like, I want this and this and this and this done. And sometimes you'll get people where they will literally just do everything. But sometimes things aren't necessary. And to me, as much as I felt like it was a necessary thing to get, a necessity to get, you know, he might have thought, no, like, you know, you still look feminine without it. But he was honest. So when I had my consultation, I then went off and basically had a 3D scan. So I had a 3D scan of my face, and oh my god, what a nightmare that was, because there was me rocking up like this. So I had my extensions and stuff in. And basically when I went in, I had to take all my piercings out, which is why you'll notice I don't have any piercings anymore, because it was just a pain in the ass to get in. So I had to take all my piercings out. And then the woman, when I went for my scan, the woman was like, do you have extensions in? And I was like, yes, why? And she went, they're showing up on the scan and it's making it very blurry. Are you able to take it out? So I went into the place looking like glamorous, glamour's on, and then I came out a hot mess. That was very ratchet. So yeah, that was interesting. So So what I wanted to say is everything in terms of consultation and my scans, I paid for myself with my own money, just putting it out there. And yeah, so going on to the surgery. So I had to take a loan out because financially I could not afford to come up with the money like that to pay for my surgery. Now I know that you can do finance schemes, but for me, I just wanted to have that money, pay it off, and then, you know, pay for the surgery and then pay it off gradually with my bank. I could have done a little bit more research into kind of loans and stuff like that and interest, but I just wanted the reassurance that I could get it with my own bank that I was with, and I got it. So my surgery in total, including doctor's fees, including hospital stay and everything like that, it came to just under 11 grand. So the surgeries itself should have been just over 5 grand. But then everything else on top of that was for doctor's fees, was for the anaesthetist, or however you say it. I'm blonde, so I've got an excuse for getting things wrong. And, you know, like the stay in the hospital. So that's why it added up to 11 grand. Well, just under 11 grand. So it was a lot of money. But, you know, we'll come into whether or not I think it was worth it. So what I did was I went to my bank and I borrowed 11 grand. And the kind of scheme that we set up was that if I borrow 11 grand, the interest rate would mean that I would have to pay back 14 grand, which is a lot. But I didn't have a credit history, so I didn't have anything behind me to say that I was paying certain things off other than my phone bill. You know, I don't have an overdraft, I don't have any, like, other debt, and I don't really have anything else to pay. You know, I pay board and whatnot, you know, I have a job, I get wages, I pay tax. But other than that, there's nothing really else that I pay out. I don't really spend stuff for myself. Like, I'm high maintenance in the fact that I like doing my hair and makeup, but I'm very low maintenance in terms of I'm not one to dress up. I tend to just wear jeans and a vest or a t-shirt, you know, so I'm not very bothered about buying clothes. So yeah, my interest was 14 grand. So I have to pay £250 a month over the course of four to five years. Now, they did say that if, you know, I am paying it off and they can see that I'm paying it off with no struggle, that there may be a possibility that I can have a review so that maybe the interest rate could come down. And I know that I could go to another bank and possibly get a lower interest rate, but, you know, it's worth it. So, the day of my surgery. So, obviously, I have had my surgery. Now, the experience, I had no idea what I was planning getting myself into. All I'd seen was videos on YouTube, and I'd watched, you know, so many documentaries, and I'd also read so much. So there was a lot of information that I embedded into my brain to know what to expect. And one of the things that I had read about was that you can, when you've had surgery, you can swallow a lot of blood, and then that may lead to vomiting. So after I had my surgery, that had happened. So I went down for my surgery. I was very, very nervous. They had to put a catheter in me because obviously the surgery was going to be quite long. And I was really nervous because I was like, oh my God, they're going to see, you know, what's down there. But then, you know, my family was like, look, like, you're going to be asleep, so you're not even going to know. And that kind of like made me think, okay, I don't really need to know if they've seen or whatnot. But my nurse, Catherine, was absolutely amazing. She was so lovely, very, very sweet and supportive and basically was just there for me when I needed her. Unfortunately, she was only there for the first night, and then I had different nurses each day. So I had my surgery and I was put under with the anaesthetic, and I was dreaming. And I'd say that the dreams felt maybe about 5 to 10 minutes before I then woke up, my dog's trying to get in. So bless them, they just can't live without me. So yeah, basically I had been dreaming, and I was dreaming about work and whatnot, because I always dream about work. And then I woke up, and it took a while for me to kind of figure out what had happened. But I was in no pain, and I had no pain throughout my whole surgery. You know, in the recovery, there was no pain at all. And that was one thing that I was really surprised about. You know, every time the nurses kept coming into my room, there was like on a scale of 1 to 5 or whatever, like, where's your pain? And it was always like 1, maybe 2, and the 2 was more for discomfort. So I was really surprised at that, and I think if I'd known that the pain wasn't going to be there because I was on so many drugs, like proper high and all, I probably would have done it sooner. You know, that was one thing that freaked me out about surgery, was the pain. So I had no swelling when I came round, so I pretty much could see everything. Obviously my nose was bandaged up, and I was bandaged up quite bad, but when they changed my dressing around my jaw, I had a dressing around my head to kind of like keep everything tight, otherwise my head would have been out here. I got to see my jaw on like the first day because I had no swelling. And I was really emotional, you know, all I did was kept crying. And I was crying for happiness, but I was also crying because I was like, you know, did I do the right thing or not? And that's what happens when you're under, you know, when you have an anaesthetic, is the fact that like you can get quite down on yourself, like because you've got the drug that's in your system and it takes a while for that drug to come out. So over the course of a couple of days, I was very, very emotional. If you see it in my previous video, which I'll put the link down below, you'll see that I was a very, very emotional person. And I think it's because I felt to myself, did I do the right thing? You know, was this surgery right for me? Could I have lived without this and whatnot? Did I take it too far? And I was worried about how I was going to look, because the day after, my face was so swollen that it was really hard to tell how the final result was going to be, because I didn't see any like mocked up pictures of how I was going to look. It was a case of I basically just had to have all my faith into this doctor to do the right, you know, job that I wanted to achieve. And yeah, so my family took care of me very, very well. Now, when I had my consultation, my surgeon said that I could go to work after 2 weeks. By the third week, I was still very, very swollen, very, very bruised, and I still had some stitches in my nose and that, which the nurses didn't take out, which they should have. So I'll come back to that in the next section. But yeah, so in total, I took a month off work. And the reason why I took a month off work is because I had 3 weeks holiday and the rest I took a sick. And to me, you know, this was such a life-changing surgery and such an intense surgery that I wanted everything to be ready. There were a lot of things that were going on at work at the time that were very stressful for everybody. And I wanted to kind of take myself out of that equation and come back when everything was calmer, when everything was a bit, you know, less stressful. Just because I was healing and I wanted to make sure that my healing was smooth. So I did take a full month off work, and I think that was the best thing I ever did, because I got to think about myself for once, and I got to take time out for myself to just make sure that I was the fittest shape that I could be in for when I got back. So, before and afters. So I'm going to put some pictures up in a minute, and then you can see the before and afters, and you can kind of see the difference. So when you look at my before shot, you can see that my nose was very, very prominent, especially from the profile. It was very, very large, very, very bony looking, and it just wasn't very feminine to me. I had always wanted more of a curved nose. I always would describe it as a ski slope. And when you look at my after shot, my surgeon 100% achieved achieve that. He gave me the perfect nose that for me, for myself. So what I had done was I had a septorhinoplasty, which is where they basically straightened out my nose because it was slightly crooked. And then what they did was they did the rhinoplasty, which is where they enhanced the shape of the nose and remodified it to suit, you know, the patient's needs and wants. So for me, I wanted more of a ski slope nose. So I wanted a very curved, very soft, very feminine. And then my tip in my nose was very, very bony before. So what they did was they took a tiny bit of bone from my skull and they basically put it into the tip of my nose to kind of like reshape it. So here on this side of my head, I had like a little tuft of hair that had been shaved from where the surgeon had taken bone out to put into my nose. And it definitely made a difference. He did say that, you know, because it had been reshaped and broken, that scar tissue should form around that area. But just to give me reassurance that it was definitely not going to be as bony looking as it did before, he decided to put the bone in the side of my head into my nose. And he didn't charge me for that either. He actually didn't put that inclusion in the cost. So the longest part of my surgery was definitely my nose. In total, it was 8 hours that my surgery took, which was a lot longer than they expected. And one of the reasons being was because my wisdom tooth was coming through in the back, and because it was impacted, it got like a slight infection. So what he did was he cauterized the gum that was formed over the tooth and he took that away just so that the tooth could come through a lot easier. Instead of like being pressed against my gum. He basically cauterized that area, took it away, gave me antibiotics, obviously for everything to like heal and for the infection to go. And then that meant that my wisdom tooth could come through properly. So yeah, that I think that took a little bit longer. So what they did was to do my jaw and my chin, they basically did the surgery from inside my mouth. So from all around my gum line, I have a big scar and I definitely can see it because obviously when I pull my lip and stuff down, the scarring has definitely like, you know, changed the appearance of it. So it doesn't look as smooth anymore. When you like pull it down, it's quite like jaggedy a bit. But that's just, you know, some of that no one can see. You can't see it when I talk, you can't see it when I smile. So yeah, even when I do that, you can't see it. So I had that done and they basically took off my chin and shaved it down and then they like put it back together with like a titanium bolt, I think. And with your jaw as well, like it depends how much they can take away because of how deep your roots might be in your bone. So if you've got quite a deep root on your teeth, that can determine how much jaw bone they can take away. So with me, I still feel like, you know, it's still, you know, big, but I think it's a lot better than what it was before. And you can definitely see an improvement from my before and after pictures. It's definitely more softer. You know, this angle is a lot more feminine. And yeah, I'm just pleased about it. And then the last part of my surgery was my Adam's apple. I have my trachea shave. So I have a slight scar here. So I still have my windpipe. My windpipe will always be there. But the actual cartilage where my Adam's apple was has gone. So I'll do like a side shot. It's smooth, I'm a lot more confident with myself, and I don't need to worry about hiding my Adam's apple. So, the pros and cons of my surgery. I, without a doubt, would say the cons of my surgery are that I felt like the aftercare could have been a little bit better. There were some nurses that were absolutely amazing, but then there were some nurses that I dreaded, and that was because when I would ring my buzzer, it would take them forever to come. There was one night where I rang my buzzer because I had thrown up all this blood and I was pretty much just sat there waiting for ages for the nurses to come. And then like, you know, when they did go off to get a new gown, I was just like sat there covered in blood for ages. And yeah, like the next morning there was like one woman who came in with my breakfast, and because I couldn't really chew because I just had surgery, I did say to her, I don't think I can have the rest of my breakfast, and she walked off huffing and puffing, being like, why did I bother? So I definitely think that was the con. In terms of like the price, etc., I think it was pretty reasonable. You know, if I'd have known that I was gonna get kind of like the treatment in the hospital, I would have maybe suggested going a day earlier. But obviously, you know, I was there for a reason, to be watched, which, you know, I guess is why we have the NHS. But, well, I went private, what am I saying? So, yeah, I think they'd probably be the cons. To the pros. So, the pros of my surgery, I definitely would say, is the fact that I am so much more confident with myself. I feel like myself. I don't get nervous about going out in public anymore. I can happily go out in public without makeup and not give a shit. And yeah, I definitely feel like it's just changed me as a person. It's just made me feel so much more comfortable with myself. And I feel like I don't worry as much in situations. Like before, when I used to go to the cinema, I used to be really scared about getting up if I needed the toilet, because I'd be worried that people would be like, oh my god, that's a man. Whereas now it's like, I just don't care, because to me, I don't think that I look like a man. And to a lot of people, I don't think I look like a man either. I think the one thing that definitely gives me away is my voice and my height, because I am 5'11", you know. But other than that, I think, you know, I do pass pretty well as a woman. Tell me down below what you guys think, if you think I pass or not. But yeah, I 100% can definitely say that it was worth every penny. I am so thankful that I picked the surgeon that I did, because I feel like I look like myself, but just a more feminine version of who I am. And I felt like he listened. Now, I know there are people out there that may possibly have had surgery with Dr. Brian Musgrave who may think that he's very conservative in his ways. And I do admit, like, you know, the surgery itself was very subtle, but to me that was a good thing. I didn't want to come out looking a completely different person and not being able to recognise myself, because I wouldn't have known if I'd have liked that or not. You know, it's one thing looking feminine, but it's another looking completely alien and not feeling attractive or feeling comfortable in your own skin. You know, to me, I never thought that I was ugly before, and so I just wanted to like tweak certain bits that I knew could enhance myself and enhance my confidence. So yeah, I definitely think that the pros were the fact that it's changed my life completely. I am now a positive and confident person in terms of how I look. But yeah, I definitely say one con, however. One con is I went into this thinking that this may change my life and way of thinking, and that I wouldn't worry about my gender dysphoria anymore. The con is the fact that I still worry about my gender dysphoria. I still have days where I get down because I'm trans, but then to me, I've just realised that it's normal. I was born different and I just have to accept that. And I feel like I accept it, you know, constantly. But I am so self-critical that I will constantly compare myself to other trans women and be like, oh my god, I wish I was as pretty as them. I wish I looked like that. But then I just think I am my own person, and there will be people out there who will be thinking the same thing. You know, there'll be people out there that may be like, oh, I wish I looked like Drew, which is so alien. But, you know, it's like, I think we all probably think like that. I think the most beautiful woman in the world will always think, oh, she wishes she could look like someone else. I don't feel like everyone is fully, you know, 100% happy with who they are as a person or how they look. There's always things that I think we want to change, because we always want to better ourselves. But for me, I am so self-critical that I still have times where I'm like, oh, maybe I should get that done. Maybe I should get this done. So yeah, I guess that's a wrap up. You know, it's been 1 year. This is the final result. I don't think anything else is gonna change. And yeah, I just wanted to say thank you so much to everybody out there who has watched my videos, followed my journey, and even though I've been away for a while, you have continued to follow me, whether it's on Instagram, Twitter, Facebook. You know, you guys are amazing, and I honestly, deep down in my heart, just want to say thank you so much for all your support, because there is no way I could be here today without the support of my family, my friends, and just you guys. You are the ones that keep me going, you are the ones that keep me sane, you know, and whenever I need someone to talk to, I'll always get straight onto Facebook and be like, does anybody want to chat? And then I can just reach out to you. So thank you so much. And I just want to say as well, thank you so much to the people who donated to my surgery fund. You know, that made such a massive difference. I made, I think, about £500. And yeah, that's over the course of 5 years. And I just want to say that money helped me so much, because I got to use that to help pay for, you know, my scans and just, you know, things in terms of like aftercare, like, you know, things that I may have needed. You have helped me so, so much, and I can't thank you enough. And I guess, you know, my way of thanking you is dedicating this video to you, because without the supporters out there and without my friends and my family, I probably wouldn't have had this surgery, because I was very scared and just very kind of like, I never thought that getting a loan could be so easy. You know, I always thought that I would have to work for the rest of my life to get to where I am now to pay for this. And I know that there are some people out there that do have to do that, but you know, I was very fortunate that I could get a loan and that I am able to pay it off every month. So I just want to say again, thank you so much. Honestly, you guys are amazing, and this video is not only for me to look back on when I'm older, but for you guys to know that you were a part of this. You were a part of changing my life and making me feel so much better inside. So yeah. I'll put all my links down below for my social media if you do want to follow me. I just want to put it out there that my Facebook page has changed. So I have two accounts, which I know some people are confused about. One account is Drew-Ashlyn Cunningham, which is in brackets private. Now that's my personal Facebook page that I use to keep in contact with my work colleagues, my family, and my very, very close friends that I may see on, you know, a daily or weekly basis. So I very, very rarely use that page. If you are on that, you'll notice that I've invited you all to like my other page. So my other page before was called Real Drew-Ashlyn, and that was a page that my sister had created for me, which was a fan page, and that was to kind of keep up to date with my journey since my transsexual summer. At the moment though, however, it has changed its name. So it is no longer called Real Drew-Ashlyn. You can look it up with the link. The link is now TS Drew-Ashlyn. I'll put everything down below. So it's still the same page as Real Drew-Ashlyn, however, I've just changed the title of it. So it is now called TS Drew-Ashlyn. And sometimes when you're typing it in onto Facebook, you just need to put Drew-Ashlyn, so you will be able to see it. You'll notice my private account has a profile picture where I am, I've got the link to my like page, and then my like page, I am pretty sure my profile picture, I have a unicorn beanie on and long blue hair. So that is the official page. So if you are on Facebook and you do want to follow me, I am always posting on a daily basis. If you message me, I will try my best to constantly keep up to date with it. And yeah, so thank you so much, and mwah, take care guys, peace out, love you, bye. Ah, I just fell. It's because I'm sat on a pillow, innit? Zah.